Okay, so that's all about integration and project challenges and related things. But I also want to pick your brain on some more
Okay.
technical issues.
Yeah.
So I've been checking out your website a little bit,
Yeah.
and one thing I came across was a nice word, a data lake.
Yeah.
Tell us, what is a data
Yeah,
lake?
maybe before I do that, let me just, our website is very much outdated, and we're very good engineers, but terrible marketing people. So we're kind of working on a new website, but that being said, what is a data lake? So it used to be that to do any kind of analytics on data, you had this notion of a data warehouse where you would grab data from all your operational systems, from your ERP system, from your CRM system, and you would put that in a big SQL database, more or less. You would do very nice dimensional modeling or whatever kind of modeling you want on that, and you had like very nice financial reports. The problem with that data warehousing approach was that the data was coming in at such a high pace, and there was an explosion of data sources like clickstream data, and less started fitting in a data warehouse. So they kind of turned that around. They said, instead of trying to model the entire world, let's just land all the data we have and try to structure it as we need. So it's more what they call schema on read instead of schema on write. So I can just dump all the data there, and then when I read it, then I'll figure out what's in there. Now, the catch there, of course, is if you go all the way overboard and just dump data there, you get a data swamp. So nobody understands anymore what's in there. So the trick in a data lake is to collect all the data without asking a lot of questions, but then step one, structuring all the data. So the first thing you do is try to understand, okay, what are the fields in here? Is it the JSON file, CSV? Is it whatever? And trying to structure it, try to align it all with one data format as much as possible, try to expose it so people can query it, and only then start creating insights.
Okay, because I see it's exposing it that triggers a question with me,
All right.
because what I have seen is that a lot of people have, or a lot of companies have worked hard to remove silos, to
Yeah.
have this one view of data,
Yeah.
but then when they start doing stuff with data, they have applications, but these applications then again in turn, they create their own internal data and you start creating silos again. So is there a way to have one true data source and expose that data to all your applications?
So yes, definitely. There are ways, and I'll try to explain them as much as I
Yes.
can. But you need to be careful that you don't fall into the same trap as what I said, the master data management program, right? So we're going to model the entire world, and we're going to have one definition for everybody, and it's going to be perfect, and we need 2 years and $5 million to make this happen. So that doesn't work for master data management. It also doesn't work here in data integration. So think about it from a technical point of view. What we're doing in big data or in data lakes is actually kind of dirty, right? So if you talk to any good software developer, they'll tell you that they're moving to a more interface-based approach. Like I have my own small service, a microservice, if you will, and other teams have their own microservice, and we only talk to each other over a very narrow interface because I don't want to expose my internals to you. I just, here's my API, and maybe I have Mongo behind the scenes, or I have a Postgres, or you don't care. I just talk to you over an interface. And then the big data people come along and they start all attaching their crawlers on the back end of all these systems, and they all try to expose all of that data into a data lake. And that's, of course, very fault tolerant, right? Because every time I, as a team, change my schema for whatever reason, the data lake is broken because you're not really respecting my interface. So I think the long-term answer is like, what is an ideal way to expose and share data is if you have clear interfaces, and it doesn't only have to be an API. If you look at one of the very cool trends now is what they call an event-driven architecture, where you have one central event hub and everybody posts messages on that event hub. Kafka is a very well-known
Yes.
example of this, where I am a registration system, and whenever somebody logs into my registration system, I said user logged in. And whenever somebody has completed registration, I say registration completed. And nobody needs to crawl data with me. Everybody can just start listening on the event of like, what is happening in real life, in real time, with the organization and all the. It's a very dumb bus, right? It's a very dumb pipe with all the information in there, but everybody can build their own intelligence on top of that. And if you in Belgium, I know a company called Vant Exclusief, and they do this quite well actually. They have a quite cool, as far as I understand it, right? I only know it from presentations how they do that, but they publish all the information on one central location, and they agree on a schema, they agree on a format, and that's how they interact with each other. It's asynchronous and it's a very clean interface. I think, so the ideal picture is companies should go there. Now let's go back to reality. If you look at a big bank or a big telco or a big retailer, I mean, they're nowhere, right? So the first step is just start talking over clean interfaces to each other. Just start using more and more APIs and stop reading from each other's databases. Mm-hmm. I think that would definitely help. So that's one way of exposing data. Maybe on the other side, if you have data scientists who want to have access to that data lake, again, you could say, well, it's all, let's say, Parquet files, and you just need Spark, you need to do this and this, and then sometimes a data scientist starts melting already, like, I don't know what this is. So ideally, you expose the data over something called Hive or Presto, where I register all my data in a data catalog, and you can just query it like any other SQL database. I think that definitely works as well, yeah.
Oh, you have to explain that, because okay. When you said you have to expose data through an API, I was like, sounds nice, but then I need to be able to foresee how you want to use my database. If I have a service and I have data in my service, I have to, instead of just saying, hey, here's my database, make any query you want, as long as it's a read query, let's say.
No,
you have to use my API, so I need to know in advance what you will ask so I can program the API. So it may be...
Yeah, so that's exactly the difficult discussion you have there. So ideally, you just give me access to your database and I'll get everything I need. But then you're exposing a lot of internals as well. So it's much more useful if you think about... I'm not going to build this gigantic monolith of a service anymore. That's not done. I'm building... Well, microservice is also a bit of a buzzword, but I'm building a microservice. So a small service that only does one thing. Like I'm building maybe the shopping cart service or whatever you want to call it. Well, if you think about it from a business point of view, a shopping cart has certain functions, right? You can add things to a shopping cart, you can have a list of items in the shopping cart, you have a total cost, you know, there's a customer link to a shopping cart. So those kind of primitives, I would say you almost expose them by default already, right?
Okay.
Just like what I need from Google in terms of clickstream data, it's very clear what I need. I want to know who clicked on which page when, right? That's more or less a very useful, very natural way of exposing that data.
Yeah. All right, very interesting. Now let's move to the more from the practical and to the more abstract.
All right.
In terms of AI and data.
Yeah.
So according to you, what is one of the largest misconceptions concerning data or AI or machine learning?
Well, I would say, and it's a bit counterintuitive maybe, but I would say there is a misconception that all data creates value. And I think that's definitely not the case. I'm thinking of a good example here, but it's not just, for instance, a very good example is when you have these very low-level machine readings of all, like what was the pressure at any moment at this valve and what was the blah, and if you're a domain expert, like you might care about valve pressure and that might be relevant for you. But I've seen plenty of organizations with such low level data at such a large volume. It's like, this is our most valuable data. Well, no, for them, actually what was way more valuable if they just had the maintenance schedule of an asset, right? Like when did it go into maintenance and what was replaced? It's a lot less sexy, right? Because that fits in Excel and this is big data, real time and blah. But actually that maintenance data proved to be a lot more valuable than the other data. And it's orders of magnitude, right? So it's not that this is 10% more valuable than that. It's no. I can really solve 80% of the use case by only looking at this data set. And maybe another good example is, and that makes it more clear, we did a project for some kind of package delivery company, which we probably all know. And we had to predict what time would a package arrive at your place. And then when you talk to business, they was like, yeah, but it really depends on the weather and it depends on who is the person delivering that. And they had even like more absurd theories than that. They had like a whole bunch of hypotheses about how the package would flow through their system and how this impacts package delivery. And actually, it turned out not to be the case at all. It turned out that simple things like what is the mode of transportation, that had an impact. It turned out that things like this is a very simple thing. If you deliver a package, sometimes you can just slide it in the letterbox, and sometimes you have to ring the door, right? But ringing the door takes you a lot longer than just sliding in the letterbox. So just knowing, like, this is a very unsexy feature, right? But can I slide it in the letterbox or do I have to ring the doorbell? That has way more predictive power than I need to capture all weather data of the last 20 years because...
Oh, that's why package delivery doesn't ring my bell anymore. They just slide in the letterbox right away.
Yeah.
All right. Second one, yeah. The future of AI. You actually have two sides. Yeah. You have the doomsday sayers. They say, oh, the robots are going to take over the world. And then you have the other camp saying, like, well, the robots, it's totally overhyped and we're actually at the threshold right now. The AI winter is coming in. Where are you in this debate?
Well, let me preface it by saying I'm not an AI expert, right? So, but what I hear is that I am a big believer that robots can do a lot of the things automated that we're now doing manually. And it doesn't even have to be robots. I think if we go into organizations, there's a lot of people just focusing, there's their day in, day out job is copying data from one system and putting it in another system, right? Like this whole bunch of administrative functions, if you just have a cool IT system, you don't need all of these functions, which in terms of efficiency is yay. In terms of societal impact, I'm slightly worried about that because it means that people, well, skilled in that kind of work, it will be hard to retrain them to do something else. So I'm a big, big, big believer of automation. We can do 10 times more automation than we're doing today. In terms of like the super intelligence or like evil robots taking over the world, I doubt it. Again, I'm not an expert, but I doubt it. What I do found interesting is that I'm definitely not good at chess, but I like to follow the chess world a little bit lately. And there you see, well, chess computers have beaten humans since decades already. So that's a solved problem. I remember when I was, it's a long time ago, when I was in university, I wrote my own chess algorithm. It's actually very simple to... And that algorithm was already good enough to beat me, but I'm poor in chess, right? So it wasn't a great algorithm. It's just not me being very good. But these kind of algorithms, they were already better than the grandmasters, but they were very boring to watch at because it's just brute compute power, and it just wasn't intuitive to human beings. But now, if you look what happened with Google AlphaZero and AlphaGo, and it wasn't just a chess engine; it was a deep neural network. And I don't know the details, but it was more or less trained to think like a human, to make intuitive moves. And AlphaGo, or AlphaZero, I should say, AlphaZero, so the chess engine of Google, is beating all engines, all other like traditional chess engines in the world. And that's super interesting, but because all of a sudden, like if you're a chess grandmaster, you can learn something from AlphaZero. Like if I'm in this position, typically then he advances his pawn structure here because then blah, 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 he always wins. You can learn something from AlphaZero as a human, like because AlphaZero thinks like you think. Well, there wasn't much to learn about these traditional chess engines. And to things like that, I do think it's quite exciting.
Okay.
I'm not worried that killer robots will be around the door. Maybe I'm wrong, I don't know, of course.
Let's hope you're not. then, in this field, if you want to learn and you want to read a book,
yeah,
which book can you... recommend.
So again, we come more from software engineering and we apply that to data than we come from data science and try to get some software engineering in there. But I think the number one book, also the book that I force everybody in the company to read, is called The Phoenix Project. And what I like about it's a fiction book. The Phoenix Project is a fiction book about a character working IT operations and everything goes wrong. Like everything is crashing down and he gets the blame from all sides. And the good thing about the second half of the book is also about how to fix that.
Okay.
And the scary thing about the Phoenix Project, if you read it and you talk to your colleagues or you talk to your clients or to anybody in IT, it's like, this author has been spying on me. Like what he described in this page, that's the meeting I had last week. And this person in the book, that's that guy in office who's really being a pain in the ass all the time. So it really hits home. It's like, it puts the finger on exactly where it's hurting the most, and then it also brings ways of how to alleviate that pain. So that's definitely, I think, the way forward with IT in general, and also data engineering, is the Phoenix Project.
Right, I will remember that one.
Yeah.
I will put it on my reading list.
Good. The more people read the Phoenix Project, the better my life becomes.
Probably I will get there in 10 years. Then, you talked a lot about, earlier in the conversation, about people. Where do you find your people? Because they're hard to find.
Yeah, of course. So, well, we were discussing earlier before we started recording that the biggest bottleneck for organizations like yours or mine is not finding clients. I mean, knock on wood, because we're happy that that our clients are happy with us. Our biggest bottleneck is finding engineers to work with those clients and to work on our projects. And we even make it more difficult on ourselves. And I guess you have a similar rule, but with us, the rule is in hiring, if it's not a hell yes, it's a no. So we've had plenty of candidates where we thought like, yeah, this person could be good, or this could work, or I can see if, then that's a no. So we only hire the person who absolutely, hell yes, this is going to be awesome. And so far we've been lucky enough that we haven't made a mistake yet, but you never know when it will come. But so where do you find those people? I think it's a cliche answer, but they find you, right? They if you're a good engineer today, and that's just reality, and you throw your CV in the air, you will have 5 offers. Most engineers, good engineers I know, they really get spammed to death by IT recruiters and headhunters. So it's really, it's good for them. It's their market, right? They go and shop for companies that they want to work for. So it's more or less like dating, right? If you, well, I'm a married man, so it's not relevant anymore to me. But if you try to date somebody and you just go to that person, and you just brag about how awesome you are, and we really need you, and come date with me, and I'm the best, and blah, like that person will be like, oh, dude, ugh. No, it's you need to have something really authentic to offer to that other person. Mm-hmm. And it's the same with hiring, right? They when we do an interview, we check their technical skills, we check their communication skills, but they as much also are checking us, like, how is it like working here, and who are my colleagues, and what kind of projects do I do? And there it's about being honest. Don't I've seen plenty of companies promising the world, like, hey, if you're going to start with us, you're going to do the best data, deep learning, blah, and we're gonna be rock stars and stuff, like all of that bullshit. And then after 3 months, they're just dragging and dropping a Tableau dashboard together, like, oh, I got screwed. So it's about being honest about, this is what we do, this is what we don't do, this is what's really cool about the company, here is some room for growth, because every company has room for growth. And if you would join us, these are the kind of problems, these are the kind of challenges that we're facing. And
cool. You said bullshit. That's a very important word, because you live in a world with a lot of hype.
Yeah.
How do you separate the bullshit from the value? What are your tricks for doing that?
You mean in talking with other people, or in learning myself, or
maybe mostly in learning?
Yeah. So I think I try to get my information from a few respected sources, right? So I said it's. I think it's better to do one Coursera course than to read 1,000 blogs. I also think it's better to read one book than to read 500 tweets or something like that. So it's about following the people you trust and you respect, try to learn from them, and try to learn from experts, right? So one of the things I like doing, I'm not doing it enough anymore, but it's you go to conferences. I don't go to conferences for talks, because the talks are usually bullshit. I go to conference talk to like the best minds in the field. And one of the conferences, I was lucky enough to sit on one table with Google database engineers. So for me, like, that's like a kid in a playground. I was like, wow, I'm on the same table as these super smart people. Or like I met Doc Cutting once. He's the guy who created Hadoop. So, and I was just too embarrassed to ask him any real questions, because he's going to think I'm stupid. But that's like, so to answer your question, network with people who you really respect and you want to learn from, read books, follow courses, and try to ignore as much as possible social media and internet hype.
Right. Then one quick dilemma, fail fast or never fail?
Yeah, that's not a dilemma at all, right? It's fail fast. unless I because, well, you gave me the question before and I had to think about this one. Never fail in something that's supposed to be your core business. So if you're a bank, never fail in making sure that my money is in my account and it's always there. And it's not, oh, I have a bug, half of your money is gone, right? No, no. Yeah. That's like that your core, you can never fail on that. But if you're only doing that, if you're only like Telenet is my internet provider, so don't fail on giving me internet. But on the other hand, that's just a commodity, right? So I'm expecting you to do that. I'm not being wowed by the fact that if I open my browser, I have the internet. That's what you're supposed to deliver to me. But on top of that, bring me a great customer experience and there iterate as much as you want and fail 99 times. If you get it right 100 times, I'm fine with that. All right.
Then the final question.
Yeah.
In the field of data engineering, there are a lot of cool companies that do really advanced stuff. You name Google, that's of course one of them.
Yeah.
Is there one company that you think how they approach stuff that's really my example? That's the North Star?
If there is one company that I look up to these days and I try to read up on is Confluent. Confluent are the people behind Kafka, more or less. And I think what I talked about earlier is the event-driven architecture, about everything on a single event hub, and they're popularizing that approach. So I, as much as possible, I try to read their blogs, I try to understand what they're doing. That doesn't mean that I always would go for Kafka, the software, but I think the people within Confluent are really thought leaders. I try to learn as much as possible from them. Yeah.
Cool. Chris, thanks a lot.
Well, thank you.
For being here. It was really interesting.
Absolutely.
I hope everybody who watched it was as interested as I was, because I thought it was really amazing. If you want to learn more about AI, keep an eye on the Frumo YouTube channel, because there is more to come there. Thank you for watching and hope to see you next time. Bye.
Bye.